many mothers crying, too many prayers bounce back from the sky. Too much talking, too much cheering, too many fathers losing sleep, too many broken hearts we can't make cry. We need love, love, love. We've got a fight for, we've got a fight for love, love, love. We've got a right to, we've got a right to love, love, love. It's the only thing. There just ain't enough of, there just ain't enough of. Too many bridges burning, too many battle lines, too many wounded dreamers left behind. Too much time spent building walls was what we found worth what we lost. Too many pages that we can't rewrite. We need love, love, love. We've got a fight for, we've got a fight for love. We've got a right to love, love, love. It's the only thing. There just ain't enough of, there just ain't enough of.
All we need, all we need.
Broken hearts we can't make cry. We need love, love, love. It's the only thing. There just ain't enough of.
Well, good morning, Crossroads Church. I can't think of a better song to begin our morning than that song. We need love.
We need love.
We need lots more love.
Yeah.
But let me put you on the spot, Joelle.
Okay.
What don't we need more of? Fill in the blank. We don't need more.
Okay, I got this. We don't need more global pandemics.
That's pretty
just
obvious.
Real talk.
Yeah.
But on a lighter note, I don't think we need any more of those digital streaming services.
I agree.
Hulu, Netflix, Amazon Prime, Disney Plus, those are just the
There's
ones we
There's still nothing
have.
To watch. There's still nothing
There's
to watch.
There's still nothing yeah. to watch. Okay, last one, and this is kind of a public service announcement. We don't need more Crocs.
Crocs.
Crocs like the shoes.
Shoe, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'm not a fan. My husband has been wearing them every day since he's been working from home, and although he's awesome, they are not awesome.
I'm glad
so
I didn't wear my Crocs.
Don't need more Crocs, people. Yeah. Okay, here's a fill in the blank right. for you. We need more blank.
Yeah, well, I would have said iced coffee, donuts, and more sunny days, but after listening to the song, I've got to say we need more love. But not the kind of love you see on TV or in the movies or you hear about on the radio, but the kind of love that we see demonstrated in the person of Jesus.
Mm-hmm, for sure. And that the Apostle Paul writes about in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Here's what he writes. He writes, "Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It's not irritable, and it keeps no record of being wrong. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up, never loses faith, is always hopeful, and endures through every circumstance."
That's the kind of love
yes.
we need. And you put all of that together, and what you have is a person. Mm-hmm. You have the person of Jesus. And it's our prayer today that we will meet, we will encounter this person named Jesus, and that he will change our lives.
Absolutely. So yeah. Let's begin with a time of singing together. We're gonna pass it off to Rhea and the band right now, but wherever you are, turn it up a little and let's sing together.
Good morning, Crossroads. I'm so glad that you guys have joined us for a time of worship today. We're going to remind ourselves of the love that God has extended towards us and praise Him for that this morning. So can we lift our voices? Let's sing this out together. Sing, Arise, My Soul.
Arise, my soul, remember this. He took my sin and He buried it. No longer I who live, now Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light.
Come on, let's sing this out together.
No, I won't boast, but in the cross that saved my soul, all else is lost.
Come on.
The crippled fear has no hold on me.
That's it.
So where, oh death, where is your sting? No longer I who live, now Jesus lives in me. For I was dead in sin, but I woke up to see the light.
Hey! This is all for our God. Let's sing this together.
All of this for Your glory. All of this for Your glory.
That's it. Come on, we lift it up.
Sing, all of this for Your glory.
Church, there's this passage in the book of Galatians. I want to read it for you. It says, my old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. God, we just come before You humbled this morning. God, ready to see Your will, Your way. God, we know that it's no longer us who live, but it's You who live in us, God. So we put our trust in You, God. You're so worthy of all of our praise and all the glory. So God, we worship You together this morning. Oh, we thank You, Jesus. Oh, we love You, Lord. We love You. Come on, we sing, church, worthy. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We sing. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Our prayer this morning that we're going to build our lives on His love, on His grace, on His peace, that He would give His life to save us, to set us free. Yes, Lord, we worship You this morning. We praise You this morning. And we declare together this morning, come on, church, I will build. And I will build my life upon
I'm not afraid to die. Give you our all today. Lord, we want to lean into your presence. We want to lean into your word. Lord, we want to plant our foundation firmly in you and in your love. Lord, we pray that your joy and your peace and your healing spreads into every corner of this world. Lord, we pray this in your holy name. Amen. Thanks so much for worshiping with us. Check out this exciting update from our pastors.
Hey friends, Pastor Tim and Pastor Chad here with you, literally on the road, because this week is the week of our Crossroads on the Road outdoor worship services.
Yeah, that's right. Starting tomorrow night, we will have outdoor services at one of our four campuses throughout the week. It's going to be an incredible service with a fun kids moment, full-on worship, a powerful message by Pastor Phil, and like we actually get to be together. I can't wait to see so many of you. But spots are limited, so we are asking that you RSVP before they fill up.
Yeah, and some of the campuses actually have all their spots full, but what's beautiful is that we are one church at four locations.
That's right.
And so you can still sign up for any of the other locations for their on-the-road service.
Yeah, and jumping into RSVP could not be easier. All you have to do is head over to cr.life, click on the event tab, and select one of the campuses that still has some spots available. Fill out the information. We can't wait to see so many of you as we do this on the road experience this week.
Yeah, and what's really awesome too is this week, besides on the road, we also have blood drives happening at Crossroads. And what's really cool is normally I would give you all the details for ways in which you could sign up for blood drives, but you guys showed up in incredible ways for the needs the American Red Cross and their blood donations that we actually, we filled all the spots at Crossroads for the blood drives. And so we just want to thank you guys for always stepping up and helping to reach the needs of our local communities.
Yeah, how incredible is that? Thank you for all of you that are donating donating blood. And thank you to those of you who continue to give financially to Crossroads. Every dollar goes to blood drives. It goes to community outreach. It goes to outdoor services, online services, and so, so much more, all to help people meet and be changed by Jesus. So if you want to give, it's really easy. You can head over to the Crossroads app. You can mail in your gift to the address that's on the screen, or you can head over to cr.life, click on the Give tab and give that way. Whichever way you choose to give, thank you.
Yeah, another thing that's coming up in the next few weeks is we have our annual church meeting that will take place on Monday, June 29th at 6:30. And if you're a member here at Crossroads, we'd love for you to be a part of that night. And it's an opportunity for staff to share, for elders to share updates of kind of how the last year has been, but also look forward with great hope and with great vision for what God might be doing in the midst of us over this next year. And so if you'd like to register for that, if you're a member here at Crossroads, you should check out cr.life to register to attend on that June 29th date.
Yeah, you guys know the drill. It's super easy to do. Hey, as we are about to enter into the message, to hear this message from Pastor Eric about prayer, I would love for us to just engage in prayer together as we prepare our hearts for this message. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Abba, Papa, thank you. Thank you that you tune in to our prayers, that you love us enough to listen to us. Will you put us in the right posture this morning? Will you set our hearts on you to hear the message that you want us to hear today? Today, as we listen to Pastor Eric give your words. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, Crossroads, so glad you're here. My name's Eric, and I just want to say thanks for tuning in today. We are right now in the middle of a teaching series that's all about prayer, and it's called Prayer for the Rest of Us. And to start our time together today, I'm going to ask us this a very important and essential question, and it's this. When you were a kid coloring a picture, did you color inside or outside the lines? It's important. I need to know. Were you an innie or were you an outie? Well, the answer to that question actually depends on your age and whether or not you were a defiant or compliant as a child. And I just want you to guess, what do you think which one I was? Do you think I was defiant or compliant? Was I disobedient or was I obedient? Now, it'll come as no, surprise to you that I was a pretty defiant kid. In fact, I rarely colored between the lines, and I always drove my elementary teachers crazy. I drove them nuts. We'd get this coloring project, and I would just color all over the project and outside the lines. I can just remember them saying, Eric, we just want you to learn to color within the lines. And I said, it's not going to happen because I want to do my own thing, go my own way, and there was no way I was going to bend my will towards their will. Because they really wanted me to be a better coloring person. In fact, they wanted my pictures to look like this. They did colored in the lines, looking beautiful, following the rules, but my pictures ended up looking a lot like this, right? It's just a hot, hot mess. It was all over the place. I didn't follow any of the rules. But there was something that happened, though, that really stuck out to my life and it really impacted me. And it was when my third grade art teacher, Mrs. Vile, said something to me. It was right after I turned in my latest Eric Peter Anderson masterpiece to her. And this is what she said to me. She said this, hey, Eric, you're missing out on the purpose of why we color. You're missing out on what the picture could look like. Now, that statement and sentiment kind of stung a little bit because I really did think I was the next Van Gogh or Rembrandt. Honestly, it's true. But I actually think those words can be applied to how many of us pray, to be very honest with you. In the words of Mrs. Viles, I think many of us are missing out on what the picture could look like. And in other words, I think we're missing out on what our lives could look like and what the world could look like if we would just pray prayers like Jesus prayed. I think we're missing out on beauty. I think we're missing out on justice and goodness and rightness, all because we pray prayers like this right here. You and I do this. We say, hey, dear God, thanks for today, and now that's out of the way, here's what I have to say. Right? We do this. We say, yep, thanks, God. I'm going to give you thanks. But then we get on to what we want to talk about and pray about. Right? That's not coloring in the line. It's not. It's really boiling our prayers down just like to a wish list. It's treating God like a genie in a bottle just so we can get what we want out of him. And when we do that, we have praying prayers like that. We actually develop this thing called the gimmies, like a serious case of the gimmies. We say, God, gimme, 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 give me. We treat him like a vending machine. And I need to tell you, my friends, I need to tell you, when we pray prayers like that, we are not going to see the kind of things that Jesus wants to show us in our lives in this world. Like, we're not. We're not going to see the goodness, the righteousness, the justice, and the beauty he wants for us. So then, my friends, what does it look like to pray something worthwhile? What does it look like to pray something lovely? What does it look like to pray, dare I say, something heavenly? Well, I'm so glad that you asked, because we're going to turn back to Jesus' model prayer in just a moment. This is the prayer that we've been really walking through in this series, and Jesus answers the questions that his disciples asked. They asked Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray. They wanted to know, teach us to pray, and Jesus' answer today is going to show us the exact prayer that can change your life and bring goodness in our world. So do you, I need to know, Crossroads, do you want to see more justice, more goodness, more beauty, more righteousness in your life and in our world? If so, this is what Jesus says. He says, I want you to pray this very simple prayer. And it's this in Matthew 6, verse 10. It says this, God, may your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, when we read this and we pray this, we don't just need to pause. We actually need to slam on the brakes and stop a little bit here, because what Jesus is doing, he is teaching us what it looks like to color within the lines, and he's showing us what the end result of prayer is, what the outcome of prayer is, and what it is, it's the ushering in of God's kingdom. Now, let me talk about this just for a second here. I know that term kingdom is a bit foreign to us, because we don't live in a land of kings and kingdoms, but the truth is, my friends, you have a kingdom, and I have a kingdom. You have a will, and I have a will. And often, your kingdom is actually where you rule and reign. Like, your kingdom is where you are in charge of everything. It could be your office, it could be your house, it could be your garage, it could be your man cave, it could be your closet, it could be just in your head, but we all have a kingdom. And, my friends, it's why when we get frustrated, when people enter our kingdom, and they don't know that we're the king or the queen, we get a little frustrated, which is why we say things to God like, hey, could you straighten them out? Like, they don't know how important I am. They don't know how right I am. They don't know how smart I am. Hey, God, can you fix them? Can you set them straight? Because they're just missing the point. They just don't get it. What Jesus is going to teach us here, and what he wants us to know, is that the problem is, for you and I, there is only one king and one kingdom, and it's his. And it's his father's. And as long as you and I, we are all about our little kingdom, as long as our eyes are on me, what I want and my desires when it comes to my prayers, where I'm just focused on my wish list, what I think I have to have today, as long as we pray those prayers, the result of those prayers is going to be the exact opposite of the beauty, the goodness, the justice and the righteousness that can come from praying the prayer that Jesus offers us. Because Jesus is saying, hey, I want you to be compliant, not defiant. I want you to surrender and submit and defer and acquiesce to God's kingdom and God's will. Because you and I, we spend so much time offering up so many prayers trying to bend God's will towards our kingdom. Right, God, would you just do what I want to do? We're trying to bend his will towards our will, to what we want. And it's kind of like a two-year-old trying to color a beautiful picture. It doesn't work out that way. And instead, my friends, I wonder, as you're hearing this weekend, I wonder what it would take for us to sincerely get to a point where we can pray, may your kingdom come soon, God. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I wonder what it would take for us to get to this spot where we can pray this prayer with authenticity and mean it. Where we get to a spot where we say, hey, God, before I go any further with this prayer, I want to let you know that your will is more important than my will. That God, I'm here praying to you. I'm not going to try and get you to bend your will towards my will. No. I'm here praying to you, God, to bend towards your will. Because you have to know the purpose of prayer is this. The purpose of prayer is to surrender our will, not to impose it. This is just true. Prayer, when it comes to prayer, we're not trying to get God to do our will. It's the exact opposite. When we pray, we're asking, hey, God, I want your will in my life. I want your will in my family. I want your will in my relationships. I want your will in my business. And I want your will in this world as it is in heaven. That's what I desire when I come to you to pray, God. It's us when it comes to praying that we relinquish our will to God's unconquerable will. In fact, even when we pray, we actually give something up as well. When we pray this prayer, we do this. We give up on our gimmies and we get in on God's kingdom. And if you're taking notes today, this is something that's really important for us. We give up on our gimmies and we get in on God's kingdom. And when we get in on God's kingdom, praying for his kingdom to come soon and for God's will to be done here just as it is in heaven, we start to see something. We start to see heaven meet earth. It's us coloring between the lines, aligning with God's purposes, and we get to see, when we do that, we get to see a moment where heaven and earth overlap. You see, when Jesus is teaching us how to pray, he's saying, hey, I want you to pray a certain way. I want you to pray that you want what's going on up there where God fully rules and fully reigns, that you want that up there to come down here. And when we pray that prayer, may your kingdom come soon, may your will be done just as it is in heaven, my friends, when we're praying that prayer, we're saying, God, we want you to bring heaven to earth now. That God, we want you to invade our space so it fully becomes your space. We're saying, hey, God, we want all of your goodness to fully come here and to overlap and to overcome all of our brokenness. And to be honest with you, just as your pastor, this is not just a normal prayer. Like, this truly is a radical, dangerous, life-altering prayer. Because when I pray, God, it's my will for your kingdom to come soon. You and I, we pray that we are claiming earth for God. It's a radical thing. We're saying, God, you know what I want? I'm praying for the removal of Satan. I'm praying for the removal of pain. I'm praying for the removal of suffering and chaos. I want all of that to be gone. And that's a dangerous prayer. But there's something you need to know about God's kingdom, and it's this. That God's kingdom has already come to earth in the person of Jesus. That through his birth, death, and resurrection, Jesus has ushered into the kingdom of heaven here on earth. The ultimate victory has been guaranteed. It has. But it's not fully realized yet. And I'm sure you know this, the battle, the war, it still wages. Even though Satan, yeah, his time and reign is limited, he is still wreaking havoc in our world today. He is still causing more pain, more suffering, more injustice. He is. And we've seen this far too often recently. That's why Jesus said to pray for God's kingdom to come and God's will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, because in far too many places, it's not. It's not. And we have had a front row seat to that over the past few months. We've seen it all over our world. We've seen it all over our country. And we've seen it right here in our backyard. But I'm wondering this weekend, I'm wondering, what would it look like for Matthew 6:10 to come true? What would it look like if heaven came down? Well, the good news is that we actually get a sneak peek of what that looks like and what we're praying for. John, a follower of Jesus, he records what that looks like. God gave him a vision of what it'll look like when heaven comes down to earth, and he recorded it in this book called Revelation, and it's a beautiful thing. I just want to show you a few sneak peeks and what it will look like and what we can anticipate and look forward to when that day when heaven meets earth. And this is what, here's what the first one. It says this in Revelation 7:16, where he says this: they, meaning us, they will never again be hungry or thirsty. They will never be scorched by the heat of the sun. I mean, can you imagine this? Just picture, no more pictures of starving children. No more families desperately trying to find food to put on their table. No more scenes of women and men and children around the world walking mile after mile after mile after mile in the heat searching for clean water. That's gone. They never have hunger or thirst again. But John keeps going. This is what he says. He says this next. He said, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and old earth had disappeared, and the sea was also gone. This is what he's saying here. He says that when the new heaven and new earth come, the sea was also gone. Now, some of you beach bums are a little bummed right now, but you need to hear this. It doesn't mean there's not going to be water or a beach. This is what it's saying. The Bible uses that phrase, the word sea, to refer to as turmoil and trouble and strife. And that's the reference here. So what John's saying, hey, in God's kingdom, it's strife-free. It means there's no more divorce. It means that there's no more racism. There's no more senseless deaths of the George Floyds and the Ahmaud Arbery's of our world. There's no more family feuds. There's no more fighting over politics. And can I get an amen? Yeah, I'll say amen all by myself, but John doesn't even stop there. Even though there's no more strife, he keeps going and he shows us this picture. He says this down in verse 4. He says, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All of these things are gone forever. Can you imagine? I know I keep saying it, but can you just picture this? No more tears. Anyone shed a few tears over the last few months, weeks, hours? I know I have. And he goes on to say, you know what? There's going to be no more death, no more dying, no more funerals, no more gut-wrenching moments where you have to watch a loved one get lowered into the ground. Just that's all gone. And he even says, no more sorrow. No more sadness, no more pain. I mean, my friends, the people, the manufacturers of Kleenex, they're going to be out of business. They're going to be out of work because John said, that's gone. It's over. And then a few verses later, in verses 25 through 27, he paints a picture of what that kingdom looks like. And this is what he says. So this is in verse 25. He says, its gates will never be closed at the end of the day. And I love this. I mean, can you imagine just for a moment with me? No more gated communities, no more doors with locks, no more keys to doors. I mean, can you imagine? Think about this. You'll never have to go looking for your keys again. And there's no more squad cars, and there's no more crime, and there's no more theft. And why he says it next? Because there is no night there. Now, if you're a night owl, you're kind of like, oh, bummer. But hold on here. That's not literally what it means, because nighttime in the biblical times actually symbolizes fear and when terrible things would happen. And John says, that day, that is gone. There is no night. And he finishes it with this way. And all the nations will bring their glory and honor into the city. Nothing evil will be allowed to enter. Nothing evil. Nothing evil. Evil. No more sin. The thing that wrecks our lives, it's over with. It's gone. And here's one more sneak peek for you, and it's this. It says this in chapter 22, verse 3. No longer will there be a curse upon anything. No longer a curse upon anything. And it makes me wondering, kind of want to ask the question, and it's this. What feels cursed in your life right now? Like, what is it? What in your life isn't right? What's broken? What's hurting? Because whatever that is, when God's kingdom fully arrives, that curse is lifted and the wrong becomes right. Now, hopefully you know now that when Jesus said to pray for God's kingdom to come and will be done on earth as it is in heaven, is that when we pray that, we're praying for all that I just described to you. All that goodness and all that beauty and all that justice and all that righteousness. We're praying for the redemption of this world, Crossroads. We're praying for this fallen earth to get set straight. So will you? Will you pray that way? Will you pray, God, will you make up there, down, up there, come down here? Will you? Will you pray in a way where you say, God, I want your will, not my will. I'm not here to bend your will towards me. God, I want your will in my life, and I want it in this world. And before you say anything, let me just tell you, just hear me out here. This kind of prayer, it doesn't end with just amen. In fact, praying this prayer does this. Praying this prayer moves us from being selfish to self-involving. It means it's us getting involved. It's not us sitting on the sidelines. No, now we go into the playing field. And we say, you know what, God? I'm in. It's not about my will anymore. I want to be a part of this. Because when you pray this prayer, you know what you're really saying? You're saying this. God, make me the answer to this prayer. God, use my life. God, would you use me? Help me to be part of the solution. Use my gifts, my passions, how you've designed me. God, make me the answer to this prayer. To this prayer that brings healing to the hurting, that helps redeem all the brokenness in our world. It helps us start to be part of the solution. And it begins with us on our knees praying this prayer, but then it leads us to rolling up our sleeves and putting on work gloves and partnering with God to fix what's broken in this world, in the world that is desperate for Jesus. And that's our hope, Crossroads. That's our hope. That we want to make Matthew 6:10 come true. That we want to color within the lines with the purpose of our lives to help up there come down here. You know what it looks like when we do that? Do you know when you pray with someone who's experiencing loss? You're bringing heaven to earth. You know when you feed someone who's hungry? Oh, you're bringing heaven to earth. You know when you forgive someone who that you shouldn't forgive, you're actually bringing heaven to earth. When your family opens up their home to a kid in the foster system or to an orphan, you're bringing heaven to earth. When you stand up and use your voice for justice, you know what you're doing? You're bringing heaven to earth. When you say yes and sign up with World Vision to run for clean water to our brothers and sisters across the world who are desperate for it, you know what you're doing? Heaven to earth. Oh, when you stand up for that kid who's just being treated terribly, being made fun of and bullied, oh, you know what you're doing for that kid? Bring heaven to earth. And that, my friends, that's when we see heaven and earth overlap. And then that's why I think Jesus says, I want you to pray this way. Because when you pray this way, you're coloring between the lines and you're aligning with God's purposes, because his purpose is to bring up there, down here. And from Jesus' perspective, it's a prayer worth praying. It's something worth working for. And it's absolutely something to live for. To sum it all up, when it comes to this prayer, what does it do? This is what it does. Heaven comes down when I give up. You're not quitting, but you're heaven comes down when you give up, and what you give up is my will for God's. You say, God, I want your way. You know, heaven arrives when we comply. Honestly, heaven arrives when we exit our kingdom and we get in on God's kingdom. And when we do that, we start to see the things that Jesus wants to see in our world, to see righteousness and beauty and healing and justice and goodness. That's what he hopes for us to see. We gotta pray for it.
And you don't have to wait for it. You, honestly, you just have to pray for it. And when you do, you get to see the picture how it was meant to be. It's a crossroads. Will you pray this prayer? God, may your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Because if you do, I gotta tell you, it changes everything. It changes your world. And better yet, it changes the world. So let's pray this prayer. May God's will be in our lives and in this world, and may we see that kind of change. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, thank you so much for giving us words to pray to you, God. But more importantly, Heavenly Father, God, thank you for showing us your will for our lives, that what you desire for us, God. And may we just have the humility to surrender to you, God, that it's not about us, it's about you. We don't want to bend you towards our will any longer, God. We want to bend towards yours, because we desire, Heavenly Father, to see what you want us to see, the beauty, the goodness, the righteousness, and the justice, the healing for our world. God, we love you. We praise you. We pray all these things in your name. Amen.
I surrender all. I surrender all.
Surrender is a beautiful thing. We don't always see it that way, but heaven comes down when we give up and we surrender to God. So what a great reminder today.
Mm-hmm. Thanks so much for being with us for this journey through this service. And we want to remind you that we have some questions that are available for you right after the service. They'll be scrolling so you can discuss this message a little bit more with whoever you're with right now, or you can always get those questions on our app or at cr.life as well. And we're really looking forward to seeing you this week, either on the road or next Sunday back here at 9 and 11 for week 4 of Prayer for the Rest of Us.
It's going to be great.
We'll see you.
Bye, everybody. Bye.